Hello, everyone. My usual greeting of in these virtual lectures is Kalispera from Athens. Today I'm myself in New York City, so Kalispera in Athens, και Kalimera in the U.S. At the recent conference at the Evgenides Foundation in Athens, I had the pleasure of meeting Jacob Moe, today's guest speaker. There I learned of his fascinating work with the Archipelago Network, particularly the projects documenting maritime trades in the Cyclades. This prompted me to invite Jacob to share his expertise on the maritime trades, focusing on boat building traditions in Syros and the Cyclades, especially in light of the challenges faced by traditional kaiki builders due to the advent of plastic boats and certain EU initiatives. And when I say EU initiatives, I mean the directives that with which the EU subsidizes the destruction of wooden boats, supposedly for the protection of fisheries. Just to give you an idea, in the last 30 years, my understanding is that more than 11,000 wooden fishing boats, all handmade, beautiful examples of our cultural patrimony, have been destroyed by crushing, thanks to this European Union idea. Therefore, today's lecture, Crafts of the Sea, Boat Building, Fishing, and Seafaring in the Cyclades, promises an engaging exploration of the urgent challenges and opportunities within the islands of the Aegean, particularly the Cyclades. The lecture will trace the historical and potential regenerative impact of wooden boat building, coastal fishing, and seafaring across Amorgos, Koufonisia, Paros, Santorini, and Syros. Our guest speaker, Jacob Moe, is a documentarian. He's an archivist and literary translator. As I said, he's the founder and principal investigator of Archipelago, the Archipelago Network, an initiative for research and documentation of the audiovisual heritage, cultural, and material knowledge of the Cyclades. Jacob's academic background includes a BA in political science from Pomona College, a school that CYA has very close contact with. We receive many students from Pomona. And then he got his master in fine arts in social documentation from the University of California in Santa Cruz. Joining the conversation as our discussant is Katerina Velentza, a maritime archaeologist and postdoctoral researcher at the University of Helsinki. Katerina has her BA in classical archaeology at King's College London. Then she went on to get her master's in maritime archaeology at the University of Southampton. And then from that same university, she completed her PhD at the PhD in archaeology. As an archaeologist, she has worked and conducted research on several archaeological projects and museums in the Mediterranean region, in the UK, and in the Baltics. Her interests range from subjects of terrestrial and maritime archaeology from the period of classical antiquity to issues of modern maritime history and ethnography. Before we go on, I want to remind everyone that this is being recorded. So if people don't want to be recorded, please switch off your cameras. Thank you again for joining us today. Your continued interest in these lectures have made them a cherished institution in our community. Without further ado, I want to pass the floor to Katerina, and the rest is yours. Thank you, Katerina.
Thank you very much, Alexis, and thank you to the CYA and Jacob for inviting me to be a discussant at this virtual lecture. As Alexis said, I'm a maritime archaeologist and currently moved on to a new position at the University of Hull in Yorkshire in England. And I have been working throughout my career in various maritime archaeological and heritage initiatives, including with traditional boats in the Aegean Sea. For the last year, I've been involved in a supporting role in the maritime trades of the Cyclades that Jacob has been working with the Archipelago Network that he has been a founder of. And today, I'm very, very excited really to be a part of this conversation and hear all of the developments of the projects on the crafts of the Aegean Sea and coordinate this seminar. So before I give the floor to the guest speaker, Jacob, I would like to go over some administrative information. Throughout the discussion, you can submit all of your questions using the chat feature at the bottom of your Zoom screen. You can see it next to the green button that says share screen. As soon as Jacob concludes his presentation, I will start the discussion and we will get to as many questions as we can covering the topics that you are interested in. So now I would like to pass the floor to Jacob Moe for his presentation with the title Crafts of the Sea, Boat Building, Fishing and Seafaring in the Cyclades. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Katerina. Thank you, Alexis, and as well, and CYA for this invitation. I think it's a very timely moment to be discussing this, and I'm also looking forward to the conversation together with all of you. So thanks for joining. So I will do my best to compress 12 months of research into a bare half hour. So bear with me, and we'll continue the conversation afterwards. I'll start with is sort of the inspiration for this project, which were stories and films that I came across in my time organizing the Syros International Film Festival since 2013 on the Cycladic island of Syros, and also from my experience working in political science and visual anthropology. We began with friends and colleagues to discuss this idea for a sort of a living archive for the region, which addressed a lack of access to tools and specifically with regard to film heritage and documenting these very vibrant and endangered forms of knowledge and culture. And we began to do that through different thematic projects on different islands. So over the past 5 years, we've completed a project on boat building in Syros, on plant biodiversity, also in Syros, on pottery, traditional pottery in the island of Sifnos, and most recently this larger multi-island project, which I'll be discussing with you today, Cycladic maritime trades. So I hope today to transport you briefly and a bit sensorially to these islands through some narratives, sounds, and brief film clips, sharing you these selected archival materials that we've produced in our on-site research during this project, as well as introducing some concepts and a kind of a textual atlas of references for the work we've been doing and the work we plan to do. So I'd like to start. Project for me, a brief silence, I'll contextualize it afterwards. So I I'm sure that of us 70, 80, 90, however many attendees, that there are 70, 80 or 90 readings of that clip that we just saw, all of which are different and all of which kind of come from our own experiences, perhaps with the Cyclades and perhaps elsewhere. But this was a clip that I came across in the historical archive of Syros almost 4 or 5 years ago, which was home video shot by a certain Mr. Rigopoulos of his family vacations in the Cyclades in the late 1960s. And specifically, it shows his family boarding a ferry to Tinos. And although it can serve as a kind of a family memory, it also serves as a document of how people moved through these islands at that time, and the ways in which even things like port infrastructure, which we take for granted back then, were very different. You can see they got on a small boat, the lanza, to get from the ferry actually ashore, because there was no actual port dock at the time. And this was one of the first clips that got me thinking about how to collect and think through all of this material that exists dispersed throughout the islands in many private collections. Here is a quote by Stuart Hall, an anthropologist and cultural thinker, which I'll just read it aloud. Cultural identities come from somewhere and have histories, but like everything which is historical, they undergo constant transformation. It goes on, but for me, the main thread of this is tradition, and what we are documenting today, both in maritime culture and elsewhere, is constantly in flux. It's not a solid notion. It's something that is not really restricted, but instead changes constantly through time. And it's something that has come up in a lot of conversations with craftspeople that we've worked with during field work. You'll see coming up in some of the interviews and material to follow. And it's this is the ethos a bit that we bring to the work we do and the way that we understand tradition and history. I will begin the present day with a very brief foray back almost 4,000 years. These are rock engravings of boats made by travelers and sailors in Syros, as photographed by Theo Rombos and Chara Pelekanu, who are two friends, activists, writers, and filmmakers based in Syros. These are engravings that span from 2000, 2500 BC, all the way up to the present day. Here, for example, you see, I think from the 1920s, a boat, and it speaks to me to the enduring and really diachronic quality of the cultural practices that that we're going to be speaking about today, and also an incredible kind of engraved archive in a way that spans really throughout Syros, and amazing research done by both of them. As they themselves mention, the practice of both building boats to travel, exchange products, goods, meet one another, exchange ideas, both in the Cyclades and the broader region, is something that has been happening for thousands of years. This history has morphed and evolved with the times, and is to this day an integral part of the Cycladic social, cultural, and economic fabric. Part of the work we did involved detailed interviews and documentation with captains, fishermen, and boat builders. And all of this has been published in initial form as a digital map that's online, which I invite you afterward to take a look at. Today I'll be playing a couple very short clips from Syros, Amorgos, Koufonisia, and elsewhere. Here is Petros Aliprandis, a third generation boat builder from a village, Ayanis, close to Nausa in Paros, in his workshop, describing a bit his introduction to the trade and a specific method of actually designing elements of wooden boats.
Εσημαδεύαμε ένα σκάφος και επειδή τότε ήταν της μόδας που κουρεύαν τα μαλλιά τους και αυτά και επειδή εγώ έχω λίγο πιο πεταχτά αυτιά, δεν στεκόταν το μολύβι το κόκκινο που έχουν οι καραβομαραγκοί. Ήθελα πιάνα του σχολείου, αυτό το μαύρο, το ψηλό το δέστο. Το ένα είναι πιο φαρδί, το άλλο είναι πιο στενό, είναι λογικό. Όταν ξεκινάς από τη μέση για να βγεις 6 καρμί μπροστά και 6 καρμί πίσω, από τη μια μεριά που σημαδεύει ο ένας και από την άλλη μεριά που σημαδεύει ο άλλος, μέχρι να βγεις μπροστά χάνει 4 πόντους. Οι 4 πόντοι που βγαίνουν θα βγει στραβό. Αλλά μ' άφησε ο παππούς μου μέχρι που βγει κάποιος μπροστά για να το καταλάβω. Αλλιώς δεν το καταλαβαίνεις.
Δηλαδή, απόψουμε αυτό εδώ και αυτό εδώ είναι η βάση του. Νομώ. Μετράμε πόσο θέλουμε μετά, αφού θα κοπεί αυτό εδώ η στρώση κάτω και λέμε, θέλουμε να είναι 6 πόντους. 6 πόντους.
Αυτό τώρα λοιπόν για να βάλεις τη σατζόλα που λέμε εμείς, αν δεν σου δείξουν, αν δεν το κάτσεις να το δεις πώς θα πάει, ναι, καρφώνεις το ξύλο. Πώς δεν τον καρφώνεις, γιατί η σατζόλα αν δεν τη βάλεις να στρώσει μόνη της και αρχίσεις εσύ και σημαδέψεις. Άμα την πας με το ζόρι κάπου να σου φύγει, ένας πόντος να φύγει, χάθηκε όλο του μετά το ξύλο. Δηλαδή φεύγεις τελείως από τα μέτρα σου. Δεν είναι ότι ξέρεις κάτι, άντα το πλανιάρουμε. Και σε ένα σκάφος δεν είναι τίποτα ίσιο. Εδώ είναι αυτό το θέμα. Με το μάτι θα το δεις, ποιο είναι λάθος, ποιο όλα αυτά είναι με το μάτι.
And yeah, Petros speaks to something which every other craftsman we've been working with and meeting with, which is the kind of oral dimension and the completely unwritten way in which this knowledge is transmitted and also makes it very, in a way, intangible. And this is something Iris Likuriotti, whose quote I've got up here, she's an architect and theorist who we invited back in 2021 to Syros to engage with the process of filmmaking as well as archival work in 5 boatyards in Syros. And her research focused on the ways in which these kinds of knowledge and a kind of craft workshop ecosystem extended from Syros to basically throughout Greece and to involve many different networks of both forestry, logging, cotton production for the cotton threads that were used and are still used to caulk boats, boat planks, as well as, of course, fishing and seafaring. So you can view it as a kind of an interconnected system of knowledges, all of which are interdependent. And if one cog in that chain disappears, it has a huge impact on everything else. Maurizio Boriello, who is a boat builder, a wooden boat builder and anthropologist, was the second person we invited to participate in the research. And part of what he brought to it was a very keen eye technically of what these craft workshops contain. This here you can see is a set of tools belonging to Master Manolis Zorzos' father, who this is a boatyard established in Ermupoli in the 1960s. Each of these objects has a story behind it, a story that, you know, could last 20, 30, 40 minutes, depending on how long we were able to stay and speak in this workshop. And each of them spoke to the incredible amount of technical knowledge that is contained in this craft. To give you just an example, Master Manolis had mentioned how it can take apprentices years just to learn the names of the tools that they would then need to use in the craft. So, you know, as an apprentice, you really would have to learn hundreds of names of things before you could even reach for them and then begin to use them. And this is just a sampling of a few of them. From Amorgos, this kind of taxonomical documentation then also spread to fishing workshops. This was a warehouse belonging to Captain Nicolas Bekris in Katapola of Amorgos. And this is a very, very small, there's about 100 or 120 of these objects, all very fine variations of similar objects, from nets to traps, to ropes, to buoys. Again, done by Maurizio Boriello as part of our field work. Here is Tarsanas shipyard, the most historic of the ones in Syros, and a Perama boat in the middle being dry docked, which is why it's painted orange. It's being repainted and maintained. And it's one of the other many forms of imagery we've created, and which maybe we can speak a bit more with Katerina about later, in terms of almost like trying to create an archaeology of the present, sort of these traces of the ways these places exist today, which will serve various purposes, which I'll talk about soon. And that extended as well to photo mosaics, which here you see, it's not a 3D rendering of the boatyard, but it's a very detailed 2D map, which can be used both kind of in a virtual museum context, as well as for educational purposes, something which extends as well to selected 3D tools, which we made using photogrammetry to create these models of specific objects from the Tarsanas shipyard, in consultation with Mikis Mavrikos, the boat builder there. We had asked him, for example, which of the tools were most important to him and his family, and which ones he would like us to document. As Mr. Philaktopoulos mentioned, here is a quote from the traditional Boat Association of Greece, which speaks to the havoc that has been wreaked by these subsidies, subsidized destruction of traditional boats. And although it might seem self-evident that the evolution and protection of such heritage should be safeguarded, there has been this systematic destruction by basically a Greek interpretation of various ministries of this EU law aimed at reducing overfishing. And instead of taking aim at some of the larger scale actors in the overfishing of the Aegean and the Mediterranean, it's been really targeting some of the smallest, I would say, the people doing the smallest amount of damage, which are these coastal fishers, parakti alia, as it's called, and the traditional wooden boats that we saw engraved on the rocks of Syros from 2,000-4,000 years ago. So part of this project's aim is to also advocate for the end of that. And there are some positive developments, which we can talk about in the Q&A, such as a boat building school, which is being established in Samos, ways in which this knowledge can actually evolve and be transmitted. And the orange boat, which you saw before in that panoramic photo, I will now take you briefly into the hull of it. This here is Manolis Zisimopoulos' Perama, which is parked in Parikia in Paros.
Καταρχήν το ξύλο είναι ζωντανός οργανισμός. Εδώ τώρα, αυτό το σκάφος τώρα είναι 50 χρονών, περίπου, και το καλοκαίρι θα δεις ότι, αν έρθει το καλοκαίρι εδώ, ότι το ρετσίνι ακόμα, πώς να σου πω, το ακουμπάς και μυρίζει, δηλαδή. Ή αν θα κόψεις ένα ξύλο, την άλλη φορά έκανα μια εργασία εκεί στη Σύρο, και κόβει ένα κομμάτι που ήθελα να το αλλάξω, και μύριζε πεύκολα. Άλλο το ξύλο, άλλο το πλαστικό. Το πλαστικό είναι για άλλες δουλειές. Το σπάσιμο για μένα δεν ισχύει αυτό. Είναι μόνο για τα ληφτικά. Κάποιο σκοπό έχουν. Όχι καλό σκοπό βέβαια. Γιατί φύγανε καΐκια αγγέλι. Κοπήκανε. Και πολλά σκάφη. Που... Αυτό ας το πούμε μας είχε μείνει.
These are short clips of longer episodes of these documentaries that are available online, with other than forthcoming in the coming weeks. I wanted to highlight a quote by Katerina, which speaks to me. It's from this paper, Maritime Archaeological Research, Sustainability and Climate Resilience, which I think paints the types of knowledge and culture that we're thinking in, frames them in this way of actually understanding them as these sustainable practices, and the ways in which Manolis's perama, this traditional boat, has actually operated for the past 60, 70 years, transporting goods throughout the Cyclades and beyond, as actually a roadmap for ways in which we can again bring sustainable, energy efficient transport to the region. And it's something that's being attempted by several groups, and I think deserves more research and support. Here, I will try and speed through these for the sake of time, apart from the trade routes that Manolis has himself traced, boat builders themselves have a wealth of knowledge, both technical and symbolic, about the marine environment. Here we see a collection of sketches and offers, prosfores, as it were, from Tarsana shipyard in Syros, which were given when a client asked for a boat. And you know, this was Georgios Mavrikos would sit and design and then send this sheet of paper over with a price. Sometimes it was quite detailed, other times it was a little less so. Here you can also see the incredible like managerial and budgeting skills that go into creating. This was for a very renowned craft, the Esperos, which was commissioned by a boat, a ship owner during the mid-1960s. And this is Georgios Mavrikos himself at work at the sala, the lofting floor, which enables you to create, if you can see those lines on the ground there, those are what enable you to make one-to-one extremely precise, basically mainframes of the boat itself. And as you can see, here's the result of the boat in progress. Something which strikes me continually in this research is the vitality of these cultures in the present day. And this quote of James Clifford, another anthropologist, for me conveys a little bit of that it's basically documenting is not about preserving, but imagining new possible futures. And it's futures that I think can be imagined with clarity from places like the Cyclades for various reasons. We move to Katapola of Amorgos, to Nicolas Vekris, a fisher whose tools and equipment you saw earlier.
Η θάλασσα μέσα δεν είναι λιβάδι, έχει νησάκια. Δεν τα βλέπουμε, έχει παιδιάδες που δεν τις βλέπουμε, έχουμε οροπέδια. Μες στη θάλασσα, εκατοντάδες μες στο Αιγαίο και στη Μεσόγειο, ωραία. Όταν λοιπόν είναι ένα νησάκι μες στη θάλασσα, μια κορυφή μόλις 30 μέτρων, μια έκθεση δηλαδή ένα τετραγωνικό χιλιόμετρο, για να το βρεις μες στο Αιγαίο, μες στο Πέλαγος, πρέπει να σου να... και να ξέρει να βγάζει μια πορεία, να πάει να το βρεις. Από το πάρεις το χάρτη, να βγάζει το στίγμα, για να το βρεις. Και δεν είναι μόνο το βυθός, η θάλασσα δεν είναι μια λίμνη ασάλευτη. Η θάλασσα με τα ρέματα θάλασσα είναι δούναβης. Κινείται με λιγκιώδη ταχύτητα. Και ανάλογα τις περιπτώσεις σε διαφορετικές κατευθύνσεις και με διαφορετικές ταχύτητες κινείται η θάλασσα αυτή, η όγκη. Εκατομμύρια κυβικά μετακινούνται. Δεν είναι, θέλει υπολογισμούς πολλούς. Εμπειρία. Δεν υπάρχει, πιάσαμε το κομπιούτερ και τα βγάλαμε. Όλα είναι εμπειρία. Αρκεί να παρακολουθείς αυτό που κάνεις. Με το μάτι.
This brings to me to mind this French writer and theorist from Martinique, Edward Cusant, who speaks of a certain way of archipelagic thinking, which is basically thinking not with the continent and with these large kind of imposing ways of thinking, but thinking really from the periphery, from the island, from, in a way, with the sea, as to me Nicolas Vecris himself proposes. I have, these are now several sounds. I think for the sake of time, I'll just play one of them actually, but I wanted to highlight the also sensorial nature of the documentation we're doing. These were recordings done of diesel engines, of casting nets, of onboard radios, and work songs that are sung by fishermen when repairing the boats on shore, all of which are part of this kind of sonic environment of the craft. So let's see, I will go play this one of them. And if you, yeah, if you feel like turning the volume up a tiny bit or even closing your eyes, you may find yourself transported to a little fishing boat outside of, off the coast of Paros. That was a bit of the engines and reversing as the nets were being cast of Dimitris Kiavas, a fisher in Nausa and Paros. Part of the work we're doing is also about archival and a kind of almost like a counter archival. If archives to you kind of bring to mind big state libraries where things are guarded and often not accessible, we're often looking for the ways in which some of these memories and things can be retrieved in the cracks between that more institutional framework. So we're working with a lot of personal archives and often with archives that are in the process of being lost. This one example of that is this really wonderful collection of a British consul and telegraph operator working in Syros in the 1920s and 30s, G.H. Mate, Gordon Harold Mate, who was also an amateur photographer and in his spare time would walk around the harbor communities of Hermopolis and photograph. And this, in a way, is the kind of alternative archive to the traditional portraiture that you may have seen from Hermopolis and Syros, which is of families in aristocratic surroundings. Meanwhile, of course, the fishermen and the dock workers of Hermopolis were living right nearby. And this is the first time we had even seen how, you know, they dressed and these photographs, which were bequeathed and provided to us by his daughter, who now lives in England, are a kind of visual evidence and testimony of that. And here is Gordon Harold Mate himself in what might be the first selfie of Syros. This was in the 1920s. He posed by an olive tree and set up the camera and took a picture of himself. And again, a quote that I think speaks to me to this idea of perhaps trying to document things that were never engraved or written, an alternative history. I think in the sake of time, I will have to move through this clip, unfortunately, and go through these photographs to one last video before opening it up to discussion. So here in here we are in Santorini with a new generation of fisher people, fisher women to be precise, that are beginning to think about sustainability in new ways.
Είναι ταυτότητα για μας εδώ στην Ελλάδα τα ξύλινα αυτά τα παραδοσιακά σκάφη και η δουλειά του ψαρά είναι η δουλειά η οποία έθρεψε τις δύο προηγούμενες γενιές. Θεωρώ ότι είναι πάρα πολύ σημαντικό να υπάρξει και στο μέλλον και εννοείται ο κόσμος εξελίσσεται, η κοινωνία εξελίσσεται, θα υπάρξει με τον τρόπο που το θέλει η νέα γενιά, στο βαθμό που σέβεται η νέα γενιά τη θάλασσα, δηλαδή στο βαθμό που σεβόμαστε και εμείς πλέον τη θάλασσα και μπορούμε να ζούμε από τη θάλασσα με, το, με την καθημερινότητά μας, δηλαδή το τι κάνουμε από την ώρα που θα ξυπνήσουμε μέχρι το βράδυ, πόσο πλαστικό χρησιμοποιούμε, πόσα... Τι θα παραγγείλουμε να φάμε. Όλα αυτά είναι επιλογές οι οποίες θα καθορίσουν και για μας το μέλλον και γενικά στη φύση αλλά και στη θάλασσα και για τις επόμενες γενιές. Και νομίζω ότι το κομμάτι του αλευτικού τουρισμού, επειδή παντρεύει το παλιό με το σύγχρονο, είναι το μέλλον σε αυτό, γιατί θα συνδυάζει όλα αυτά.
Well, in closing, I wanted to also note this kind of the role that tourism and development is playing in the kind of homogenization of many of these places, which some may consider this almost one-dimensional holiday landscape, which to the contrary is a very real community composed of contradictions, of very diverse populations, and one example of that here is this collection from Santorini, which I'm sure you are familiar with if you haven't been, even from the kind of the popular imagination of the place. But this is in Ia, the place known for its Instagrammable sunsets. In the 1980s and 90s, there was a boat builder who was incredibly, had his workshop in the middle of this traditional settlement and had to devise a way to bring the boats down to the sea through this incredible, elaborate community ritual. That was documented through these photographs. Marcos Trullos is the name of the boat builder, part of an incredible series of photographs which were provided by the Santorini archive project. And this is the final launch of the boat down down by the sea. So in ending, I think in these times that we are living in, it would behoove us all to think about all of these dynamics and actually the ways in which we can be learning from and with these practices for the future, for things like climate adaptation, for things like sustainable development, to ensure that these islands exist in the ways that they have for generations to come. So I'll close on that. Here are some of the references from the collections included today, and all of this is available for browsing, reuse, research, and art making on our website, with a lot more to come, including exhibitions and screenings in the coming weeks. So, but I'll leave it at that and look forward to hearing your thoughts and discussion now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jacob, for this very, very interesting talk. And I'm really, as I've told you before, I'm really impressed with all of the material that you have collected in this year. I think you have created a really, really important archive that it's going to be very exciting for many scholars to work on for many years to come. But also it's a really important archive that highlights the various traditional crafts, but also life ways of the Aegean that if they haven't disappeared, they're rapidly disappearing right now. And I think it's a good archive to also create some awareness of how people used to live in balance with the natural environment. And they had this experiential understanding of both the sea and the islands, the terrestrial part that they were living in. But this has been getting really lost over the last few years. So I do believe that this archive is an amazing accomplishment that you've had with the Archipelago Network. So really well done for creating this and presenting this to us. Right now, in the discussion, you can write, as I said before, all of your questions in the chat for Jacob, and I will read them out for him. We already have one question that maybe we can address. Christian is writing, thank you for the excellent talk. I have a question of more technical nature. What are your strategies for long-term archiving of all of the data you have collected? And how are you making this data accessible to the public?
Thank you. It's a really useful question and one we're thinking a lot about. I think there's two levels I think I can answer on. One, in a more immediate sense, we're partnering with local institutions such as the University of the Aegean, which has a branch in Syros, which has an existing repository. That we are providing all of our content to, and that will ensure from kind of a more immediate sustainability perspective that the data will be safe with an institution that is able to guarantee kind of a long-term plan for it, apart from our own repository, which we manage. And there's a kind of a technical aspect to that as well, which is about not only the quantity of data that you have, but the quality that you have for it. And that's expressed in essentially metadata, which means the information you have about the individual archives. So if I have a photo, like the one I showed you of Santorini, who took it? When was it taken? What are the technical characteristics of the actual photo? What information does it contain? All of that has to be documented. And we do document that according to specific protocols, which are established by European, basically, portals for cultural heritage. But there is I'm fascinated by the more macro and perhaps, the more macro aspect of the question you pose, which is that digital data is inherently unstable. And we are really looking into much longer term strategies for what we can do to ensure the sustainability of this archive, because in fact, technologies change so quickly that even the biggest and most well-resourced archives in the world will tell you that they don't know what they're gonna be doing to migrate their data to in 5 years, let alone 10 years or 20 or 30 years. So it's a big open question, and I would be curious to hear if you have any thoughts on it as well.
Thank you very much, Jacob, for this. We have one more comment and question. The last video, this is by Ben Mo. The last video mentioned the potential future for maritime culture being fishing tourism. I'm curious what interesting initiatives you've seen there and how you think it will maintain and transform these traditional maritime fishing practices.
Yeah, fishing tourism is an example of how, to speak also to the breaking of traditional boats, it's a solution there, because you're basically enabling these boats to be used, and fishermen are often making the same income, if not more, than they were from traditional fishing, but having a much smaller impact on the environment, just in terms of how much they're fishing. So it is quite promising. I think there's ways in which it can be done that are much more in tune with kind of cultural and historical practices and processes, and ways in which it can become very commodified. There are many initiatives, some of which Katerina has also been working with and researching, including sustainable transport of goods via sail and kind of renewable energies. So part of what we want to do and open up with this kind of more historic cultural angle is to connect these different initiatives and support them in different ways. But there are a lot of things happening now, beginning to happen on the island.
I think I agree with you, Jacob. These initiatives are really, really important. And from my research too, it was obvious that people who are working either with boat building or fishing are really open to do new things that could support sustainability, and they kind of know and they are aware of how sustainable their practices are. But unfortunately, I think the big problem is policy and policymakers that, as you said earlier in your talk, they have misinterpreted the EU laws, and they have been targeting the small fishers because it's an easy target to convince to take the subsidies to stop fishing rather than the bigger actors in this whole thing. So it's really important that you've been documenting all this. We have some more questions. Emily says, I saw you skipped over a photo of the Scopoletis from Amorgos. Can you comment on how typical or atypical the ship is for the Cyclades?
Yeah, the Scopoletis family, which indeed we had to skip over it because of time, but it's they are in a way the perfect example of how fishing, cargo transport, and boat building and seafaring all kind of come together. They're a family that over several generations have basically been the lifeline of the small Cyclades, these small islands that are fairly close to Naxos. And I believe, I imagine, Emily, the boat you're speaking about is the actual, the metal-hulled, more sort of familiar passenger boat that that they use. And they began actually as transporting passengers and goods on a wooden boat over almost 100 years ago. And now that was the two boats ago, the one that you saw in that photo. And it was fairly typical for a passenger boat, kind of a wooden, a steel-hulled passenger boat in the Cyclades at the time, but it actually wasn't built in Greece, that specific one. Yeah.
We have a question from John Camp saying, how many active boatyards are operating in Greece today making wooden boats? Which we both know, Jacob, from Costas' work, but you can answer.
The answer is very few. If we're going to be talking about boats where you could actually walk up today and go and get an offer and have a boat built in a time frame that is reasonable, I think we're really talking about perhaps no more than 10, five or 10, and even those are not fully functional. And I would refer you, as Katerina mentioned, yeah, there's really wonderful work being done on a national scale by Kostas Damianidis and the Samos Boatbuilding Museum. And there is a map, which I can refer to you to, which actually has the active boatyards pinned all across the country, if you're interested in looking into that.
Yeah, so if you go to the website woodenboats.gr, in the Greek version, there is an actual Google map with pins of all of the boatyards. I don't know if people can see it in the chat, but I can pop it in there in case it is visible. So we have a few more questions. Are you connecting with others around the Mediterranean in documenting and preserving the Cycladic maritime history?
We are, and in fact, Maurizio Borriello, who is my main partner on this project, works at a wonderful boatyard and maritime museum in Spain, in San Sebastian. And one of the next steps of this project is to try to actually implement that model for a kind of a living museum boatyard in the Cyclades. So taking selectively adapting practices around how to successfully maintain these kinds of spaces from around Europe, including Spain and Croatia as examples, is something we're working on as a next phase.
We also have a question and a comment from Elizabeth Filiotis, who says, I know of a group in Santorini who take people fishing, but then cook the invasive species on board. Do you know of the CPF, Cycladic Preservation Fund, who help fund these types of projects?
Yes, indeed. And we've worked with CPF on a small project actually about plant biodiversity on Themis, on Syros. And they're doing really, if any of you are interested in exploring further in the environmental direction, CPF is doing fantastic work mapping out a lot of these civil society actors and island groups of citizens making a difference. Yes, the invasives, that's a fun project, cooking the invasive species.
We have one more question from Nelson Moe saying, in what ways does climate change intersect with your project, with the changing Aegean Cycladic ecosystem? Is there a concrete quantifiable aspect, measurable climate change? Does climate change figure into the imagination of the boat builders?
Yeah, so some of Katerina's research is actually working with this, the ways in which even at an international level, whether it's at the UN or that there's renewed interest from a policy level about understanding what is called sort of local and situated knowledge. So the idea that maybe like somebody in Brussels doesn't have the ability to make the best plan for a coastal community where the fishermen have known exactly how the weather works and when the tides come in and out and how the winds change over the seasons, et cetera. So this kinds of there's ways in which climate change is exacerbating all of that, to be sure. Yeah, it's something that island communities do in a sense feel the future first because they are so close to sea level. So it's something that's definitely already impacting the weather and impacting fish populations. Fishermen are talking about not being able to fish the same species as they did in the past because they're shifting because of warmer waters. Yeah, I mean, the imagination of boat builders with regards to the marine environment is a whole, I think we could do a whole nother, maybe like an hour on that topic. It's really incredible the sorts of, yeah, the kinds of things that one comes to know from working over 40, 50, 60 years with all of these materials. So.
Yeah, and just to add to that, as you were saying, the local knowledge, or also known as traditional knowledge, that people have there. In one of your videos, there was one of the boat builders was explaining of how they know about the seabed very well, and how you need to be very experienced to navigate. That is very important, and it needs to be taken into consideration more in making all of the climate change policies, because as Jacob was saying, if you don't live there, you don't have this like long-term understanding of how the environment works, or what happens after an extreme weather effect, which have happened in the past, of course, not in the scale that we're talking about today, but there's been changes in the past. So yeah, it's really important. And we understand this very well from all this archival material that the Archipelago Network, for example, has collected. We have a lot more questions, so I'll try to get through as many as possible. One question says, are we seeing the prospect of long-term extinction of the wooden boats? Are there tax incentives to support them?
We're at a moment where it's really hanging in the balance, and that's I think part of the impetus for this project. You saw the numbers, and I think there's actually a next round of subsidized destruction basically planned for this coming year that's going to be announced. So we're actively lobbying against that. I really there's a lot of people with proposed solutions, and for me, tax incentives are would only be a very small part of the solution. The real solution is to address the issue at the source, which is that touristic and other commercial uses for wooden boats has been rapidly declining, and I think you need to create kind of a market purpose for them. Fishermen need to be using them. People need to be using them for travels, and that will then spur, I think, all kinds of innovation around how actually the construction process could be more sustainable and many things. So I don't believe that much in tax subsidies and incentives because I think it's just a kind of a palliative, but it's part of the solution.
Yeah, in
I
my
think.
research, which complements what Jacob has been seeing, it was also obvious that the shipbuilders at least need to be protected as some sort of endangered art and intangible heritage that is going to be lost very soon. So there needs to be like an extra level of like different kind of policy treatment towards them, that they are not just businessmen. They are not just random businessmen that have some sort of Aegean business. They are actually carriers of an intangible knowledge that is really important for the Aegean. And this sort of recognition is really hard, of course, to achieve, but this would be kind of the ideal that we would like to see, but we'll see about that. We also have some questions from Alexis Philaktopoulos, who says, can you describe the features that make a kaiki a perama, and can you say some more things about the wooden shipbuilding school at Ireo in Samos?
Yeah, the perama is very characteristic of the East Aegean, it's kind of marked by the ways in which the handrails, the rails at the aft and stern are shaped. And it's known for being a very like capacious, it's got a very wide middle, which makes it very good for carrying cargo and also storing fish. So it's like the one that you saw in Tarsanas. And
this is Damianidis' book. You can read all about the exact characteristics and technical details of how the ships are distinguishable.
Regarding the wooden shipbuilding school, I know it's in Samos. It's going to be a museum and a training school simultaneously. It's a really a long-term project led by Kostas Damianidis, and with any luck, it'll be opening in part by this fall and then in full shortly after that. And the idea is it'll be a place for Greeks and international apprentices to learn the craft, with many Greek boat builders who will be participating as teachers. There's a website with lots of information. If you want to take the one that Katerina shared, actually woodenboats.gr does have information about updates with the museum, but it's a very hopeful sign.
Well, if there aren't any more questions, I would like to thank Jacob again for this very informative session and for all of you for coming today. And I would like to pass the floor again to Alexis for his concluding remarks.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Jacob. This was very interesting, really. And thank you, Katerina. I really cannot imagine the Aegean without wooden boats. Somehow the idea of plastic boats doesn't jive well with what we know the Aegean to be. But in the long run, we may have to get acquainted, get used to this. I want to thank you both. It was a very interesting lecture. I'm surprised you didn't make mention of the club that exists for the protection of wooden boats or traditional boats, as they're called. Σύλλογος για την προστασία των παραδοσιακών σκαφών. Perhaps interested listeners, participants of today's talk may want to look up its website. And I'm sure the Silogos needs all the protection, all the support it can find. Anyway, thank you very, very much again. I want to conclude by saying that we have an exciting new lecture coming up on the 3rd of April. Natalia Vogeikov, the director of the archives of the American School of Classical Studies in Athens, will discuss research she has conducted over the years concerning American humanitarianism in Greece. There is a very interesting, or there was, perhaps it's over now, a very, very interesting exhibit at the American School of Classical Studies on the subject, and I think she will discuss the exhibit as well. The email invitation for this lecture will go out shortly, so make sure you can register. Thank you again for participating tonight. Your engagement and enthusiasm makes these lectures a success. We look forward to seeing you in April for our next session. Thank you. Bye-bye.